this okay? So these are the relevant exercises. Whether this theory of course also has fermions, which I have not written down. Okay. Roughly there are half the fermions that we have for type 2. Okay. And there are additional fermions which are the fermionic partner of these gauge fields. Okay. So those are in the adjoint representation. Baryon-Weil-Spinner in 10 dimensions. Okay. So before I conclude this, let me write the resulting terms of the canonical metric. So we introduce canonical metrics G mu nu exactly in the same way as before. So it's E to be phi by 2 times G mu nu. And I'll leave it as an exercise to check that the action in the canonical metric takes the following form. Okay, so this then covers heterotic, the both heterotic supergravities, okay, S32 and E8 plus E8. Okay. So there is one more supergravity theory that you have to discuss, that's the type 1. Okay, that's the final consistent string theory that you have in 10 dimensions. Type 1. So type 1 superstring theory essentially is type 2B. Okay, it's obtained by taking type 2B string theory and taking a quotient by omega, where omega is one-sheet parity. So essentially what it does is it takes the left movers and the right movers on the one-sheet and exchanges. Okay, that's the symmetry by which you mod out, which means that you keep only those states in the theory which are invariant under this transformation. Okay, so if we look at the spectrum, okay, in the NS sector in type 2B, and I should say that this we can do only in type 2B but not in type 2A, because type 2A to begin with doesn't have this symmetry. Okay, in type 2A, the on the worldsheet, the left moving sector on the worldsheet and the right sector on the worldsheet have opposite chiralities in the from the space-time viewpoint. Okay, that's the way we got in type 2a. The two gravitinos that we got had opposite chirality. Okay, because one comes from left movers, one comes from right movers. Type 2b, the two gravitinos have the same chirality, and that's what shows that you have an exchange symmetry between the left and right moving sectors of the world sheet. Okay, so what happens under this projection is in the NSNS sector, you keep the metric and you keep the phi, but there is no b mu nu. Okay? B mu nu is projected out. In the RR sector, C0 is gone, C2 is there, and C4 again is projected out. Okay. So your states are G mu nu, phi, and C2. But it turns out that once you have this orientiform projection, you generate some negative Ramon-Ramon charge, which has to be cancelled. Because otherwise you will not get a solution to classical equations of motion. So you have to put 32 D9 brains in the background to have zero Ramon-Ramon charge. Okay, so you have to add 32 D9 brains. Okay, which gives rise to SO32. So let me emphasize, these are coming from open strings. Whereas these fields are all closed string fields. So of these five string theories, type 1 is the unique one, where part of the states come from open string spectrum, part comes from the closed string. Okay, all other four string theories have all the string states coming from closed strings. Okay, so let me write down the action. So the action has three pieces. So first, the NSNS sector action is 1 over 2 kappa 10 square. Find this in a minute, and then the gauge field action, which comes from open strings. This is Focus on the EF is defined exactly in the same way as before. These are the S32 gauge fields. Okay, so this is defined in terms of the S32. These are the gauge field strengths. So these are defined in the standard way in terms of S32 gauge fields. Now you notice that these parts, as in type 2A, okay, the Nehru-Schwarz sector axon has an overall e^-2 -2.5. Ramon sector has no e^-2 -2.5. These are, of course, what you have seen in the type 2 case. This one is a little strange because it has e^-5. Okay. e^-5, we are good, was like G string, right? So this is like a term of order 1 over G string in front of the action. And that has to do with the fact that these are coming from open strings which live on the debrand. Okay. And the debrand tension goes as 1 over G string. Okay, that we are familiar with. So the whole action on the debrand actually goes as 1 over G string times the appropriate fields. Okay, so in the natural units, any action that comes from debrands, okay, should have 1 over G string, and that's what you see here, as e^-5 appearing in front of the action.
So in any quadratic calculation, they will not combine.
They will not
combine with the rest of the sectors, NSNS and RR.
Well, they will combine, but you have to define your perturbation theory accordingly. The perturbation theory is always defined in powers of G string. Right? So these will be, so for example, the open string perturbation, okay, will dominate over the closed string perturbation. Right? So, but they will still combine. You can write down the final perturbation series as an expansion in powers of G string.
But in a particular order of G string, there might be just contributions from the open strings, but not from.
That's right. That's what may happen.
Suppose you have two open strings separating around Johnny again, and you have a closed string which is moving without interacting. Then
exactly. They
both will have the same topology, right? The surfaces.
Yeah, but if you count from here, right, that's like you are talking about one loop contribution, right? If you do the counting, you will see that whether you count from the open string picture or the closed string picture, you will get exactly the same power of G string at the end.
But you're getting the same string diagram from two different, from the open string as well as the closed string. So does this need to overcount here?
No. See, the point is, this is just low energy effective field theory, right? So here there is an overcounting. If you try to include all the fields in the open string sector, all the fields in the closed string sector, and try to draw Feynman diagrams, right? There, of course, you know that there will be overcounting, right? No string diagram, that is independent of an open string, right? If you start doing Feynman diagram calculation in the closed string, right, you will overcount because you will include the ultraviolet region and the infrared region, right, which you know are related by modular transformation. But as far as the low energy physics is concerned, see, you are not supposed to do loop calculation with this, right? Because for any loop calculation, you have to always go back to the string picture, right? So, but as far as the low energy spectrum is concerned, you can use this action. So when you talk about the perturbation expansion, right, it is indeed true that the full open string contribution, okay, will come with different powers of G string, but when you convert it to in the topological terms, you will find that whatever power of G string we expect from the counting of topology, right? The basically the genus of the surface, right? You count handles and holes and write down the appropriate order character. That always increases what you will get here, okay, from this counting. Are there any other questions? Let me define some of these terms. So basically, this F3 tilde is what you need to define. Okay, what is CI? Okay, this is normalization. Now, this I'll take to be an alpha prime over 4. Now here I should add a word of caution, which is that when I am writing these constants, if you recall, I told you last time that these coefficients could be changed by a field definition, right? If you shift phi, for example, this kappa time could change, right? That in turn can be, then you can scale the metric to change it further and so on. So I have used a very specific convention to set this ci equal to alpha prime over 4, and that is the convention in which the D-string tension, that fundamental string tension, by definition is 1 over 2 pi alpha prime. Okay, that's how we define alpha prime. But I have chosen my definition of the couplings as a D string tension is 1 over 2 pi alpha prime times e to the minus pi, expectation value of pi, right? Which I am also calling 1 over G string. Now you can see that this definition could be changed if you shift phi. Suppose you define phi as phi prime plus some constant, right? Then the relation between D string tension and fundamental string tension will change. So the way I have chosen the phi, the D string tension is precisely this. This, for example, is different from the convention that you will find in Polchinski's book. Okay, there are various factors of 2 pi sitting here. But this convention makes it easier to deal with various duality transformations and so on. But you just have to keep in mind that you cannot blindly take the result from a book and apply this, okay? Because in the convention in which the formula have been written, okay, may not be this convention.
So, after doing that,
yes,
there is no freedom left to shift phi now.
No, now there is no freedom left to shift phi.
But there are other possible scalings or shiftings like the metric and all.
They're, yes, that you can do.
They're still there.
Yeah, they're still there. Okay. But this basically fixes to be basically the definition of phi that we are using is that e to the minus phi is the ratio of this string tension to fundamental string tension. Okay. That ratio is dimensionless, right? So once I have defined e to the minus phi to be that, then there's no freedom of shifting phi. Okay. Because the ratio of this string to fundamental string tension is a quantity that is physical. Okay, so F3 tilde is DC2 minus the same omega 3. Okay, and that you will see by looking at the powers of phi that appears in front of these terms. For heterotic, these powers are positive. Well, I might have written it as negative, but that's right. Or maybe I wrote this one as that this would have been positive. This would have been positive. In the heterotic, we started with e to the minus 2 phi. So g u nu by e to the phi by 2 times g u nu. So h will require more powers of g will lose. So for h definitely this will have been negative. So heterotic has the correct sign. After this has the wrong sign, this will have been plus. Okay. And this basically reflects the fact that to begin with, this is coming from Ramanujan, right? Ramanujan didn't have an e to the minus phi to begin with. Okay. So when we do this, this comes up to a positive. Right? Similarly, this one is the gauge field. Gauge field strength. Okay. This, to begin with, had one less power of e to the minus phi compared to the NSNS sector, right? NSNS started with 2 to the minus 2, 5. This started with 2 to the minus 5, right? So when you work this out, these become positive. Okay, this is plus 5 and this is plus 5, right? Otherwise, of course, this will not make sense.
So not this matching working string frame as well. Here we are computing a 9 string frame.
Yes, it will match, it will work in the string frame. It's not that the string frame margin, in the string frame metric, you also have to specify the relationship between the string metric and the heterotic and string metric in type 1. So, G mu nu of heterotic and G mu nu. So, here, G mu nu are the same. Right? And this is the reason why one always compares to the canonical frame, right? Because in the canonical frame, by definition, the coefficient of Rg has no e to the minus 5. So the metric relation is straightforward. Okay, the metric relation cannot have an e to the 5. Okay. With that, you now compare, and this is what you find. Okay, but you are right that it's, I mean, once you know this transformation, you can go back to the metric, the canonical metric, the string frame metric here, and the string frame metric there. Okay. But those two metrics will have additional e to the 5 factors letting them. Is this okay? So this led to the conjecture. Okay, so this is the second duality conjecture in 10 dimensions. The earlier one we had seen that we had a conjecture duality, self duality of type 2b. Right? Type 2b, we had conjecture was invariant under the SL2 set transformation, which was a strong weak coupling type because it that particularly tau goes to minus 1 over tau. Took strong coupling to weak coupling. Okay. So here the conjecture is that these two theories are dual. These two string theories are identical. Now, when you think of this as perturbative string theory, okay, they are definitely not identical, right? Because the kind of spectrum that you have in the heterotic is very different from the kind of spectrum that you have in type 1. Okay, only the massless fields agree, right? Massive fields have no relation to each other. Okay. However, the reason that this duality can still be true, okay, is because of this relation over here. Okay. So you see that e to the phi I is e to the minus phi n. Which means that the type 1 coupling and the heterotic coupling are related by this inverse relation. So, in the limit when the type 1 coupling is small, where you can trust the perturbative string spectrum that you find, in that limit, the heterotic string theory is strongly coupled. So, you cannot really try, you can look at the heterotic string spectrum, but that spectrum may have nothing to do with the actual spectrum of strong coupling. Okay. And so this is the reason why this duality is not obviously incorrect. Okay. This doesn't of course show that this is correct. Okay. There are various tests that have been performed for this duality to convince us that this is most likely correct. Okay. But the reason that it's not manifestly incorrect is because of this relation that the strong coupling limit of one is the weak coupling limit of the other one and vice versa.
Under the change of coupling constant,
yes,
the degrees of freedom.
The point is, the string theory has infinite number of degrees of freedom, right? So basically, the masses can get rearranged. Okay. If it has a finite number of degrees of freedom, then you are right, and you could have compared the degrees of freedom at strong coupling and weak coupling and tried to compare. Right? Maybe high temperature behavior or something. But because these have infinite number of degrees of freedom, it is certainly possible that the spectrum will rearrange itself to coincide. One of the interesting problems here is that both theories, here you can show, has a stable particle. Okay, stable particle which is not massless. And that means that as you go from the weak to strong coupling, and they have the same quantum numbers. Okay, so as you go from the weak to strong coupling, okay, that stable particle mass would continuously interpolate between the strong and weak coupling results. Nevertheless, we don't know what the interpolating formula is. Right? If you could solve the problem exactly, then you would know the interpolation formula. At present, all you know is this weak coupling expansion and the strong coupling expansion. Okay, in principle, you can calculate an expansion to any arbitrary order that you like, because string perturbation theory is well defined in both ends. Nevertheless, we don't know the exact formula that connects it.
And supersymmetry is of no help also.
This particle is not BPS, so it's not supersymmetry is of no help. That supersymmetry cannot fix the mass of the particle. Yeah, for BPS particle, in this case 10 dimensions, there are no BPS particles. Okay, so supersymmetry doesn't help in fixing the masses. In lower dimension, supersymmetry does fix. Help in fixing the masses of BPS particles, but this particular stable particle is not a BPS particle, so supersymmetry cannot tell you anything. So this basically finishes all the 5 supergravities that come from string theory. Now I'll discuss one more supergravity, which does not come directly from a string theory, but which is nevertheless important, okay, and that is 11 dimensional supergravity. Yes.
In type 1 theory, it has this 32D brain.
Yes.
That means this E field, this field has source, in the vacuum it has some source.
That's that, yes.
So in type 1 theory?
Well, no, it doesn't have a source. The point is, there are 32 D9 brains, but because you are doing this omega projection, there is also an orient default plane. And these D9 brains exactly cancel the orient default charge. So in fact, the D9 brains are necessary to cancel the charge at the point that is carried by the orient default plane. Okay. So that's the reason there is no source for C2 in the vacuum. Okay, because if there is source for C2 in the vacuum, it will not be a consistent vacuum. Right? That will mean that there is a dipole. Right? You cannot have source for a massless field in the vacuum. Right? I mean, then it's not a vacuum, right? The C2 is non-zero. Right?
Yeah.
So in vacuum, really there is no source for this. So, the next one I will discuss is 11 dimensional supergravity. Okay, as I said, this doesn't come from any string theory, at least not quantitative string theory. So, the fields here are metric, G mu nu, C mu nu rho. This is formula. Okay, this is formula but 32 component. Because this is an 11 dimensional spinner. So basically what happens in 11 dimension, of course you cannot impose wild condition. Right? There is no chirality in odd dimension. And so the minimal that you can have is a Majorana spinner, which is 32 component.
Sir, you said that there is no underlying, I mean, this is not
related from a string theory, yes.
Yes, but to begin with, you said that we are in 10 dimensions, right?
Yes.
So, this is 11.
So, this is an additional thing, right? Why it's relevant for string theory, we'll see later, right?
Yes.
Right now, we are just writing down a field theory,
yes,
right? There is, for example, no direct way of understanding the alpha violet divergence in this theory. Right? In all of these five theories that I wrote down, right, you could think of this as lower energy limit of a string theory, and that automatically regulates alpha violet divergence. Right? Here, it's not clear a priori how you can make sense of this, because this theory is highly alpha violet divergent. Okay? Nevertheless, we will see that this is relevant for string theory in some way.
Even though that is 10 dimension and this is...
Yes, this is 11 dimension, exactly. Okay, so the bosonic action here, so we define F4 as dC3, okay, the same convention that we used, and the bosonic action okay, so this is all you have. And the analog of this equation there is delta psi mu y, if you recall type 2 has 2 gravity, no? So a delta psi mu y is delta d mu epsilon I. Well, so this is a general structure. But the supersymmetries in type 2A and type 2B are different, because in type 2A, the epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 have opposite chirality. Okay, because the two gravity nodes have opposite chirality. Right? So this equation only makes sense if the corresponding epsilons also have opposite chirality. In type 2B, the two epsilons have the same chirality. Okay, they are, each of them are minor enough vile. Okay, but because they are vile, you can, there can be either left-handed vile or right-handed vile. In type 2A, both are left-handed or both are right-handed, these are equivalent. In type 2B, both are either left-handed or right-handed. Okay. Whether you declare them to be left-handed or right-handed doesn't matter. Okay. That can be changed by an appropriate transformation. In type 2A, one of them is left-handed, the other one is right-handed. Okay. That's the distinction between these two supergravities. Now, this is local supersymmetry, but a very important role is played by what is called global supersymmetry, unbroken global supersymmetry. Unbroken global. So, this transformation, the fact that this is a symmetry, this doesn't depend on what the fields are, what background you are considering. Right? This is a symmetry of the action. But global supersymmetries depend on the background. Okay. So, this refers to a background. And global supersymmetry means the delta of field, bosonic or formulaic, must vanish. Okay, these are generated by specific epsilon of x, for which delta of field is equal to 0. Okay, when this is when evaluated on the background. Okay, so I'll discuss simple example which will make it clear. So let's suppose you have heterotic of type 1. Consider the background that G mu nu is eta mu nu, all other fields 0. So we have to check if there is any epsilon of x for which this holds for all fields on this side. Now suppose you have a bosonic field here. Delta boson involves odd number of formula fields. Okay? It's epsilon, but the field combination is odd number of formulas, which basically means that in this background, because all the formula fields are zero, delta bosons are automatically zero. Okay, in fact, this is the kind of background we will always consider. Okay, the background in which the formula fields are zero, because you want to maintain Lorentz invariance of the background. Okay, if you are looking for the vacuum. So delta bosons will always be zero. Okay, you never have to worry about whether delta bosons is zero or not. Okay, because the formula fields are set to zero. Delta formulas typically involve bosonic fields. Okay. Those can be non-zero. Right, because delta of epsilon, delta formula involves bosonic fields, and the bosonic fields are in general non-zero in the background. So let's see what about this background, G mu nu equal to eta mu. In this background, if you look at delta psi mu I, it's 0 epsilon. Okay, in fact, since all the background is trivial, these terms, even if they are present, they all vanish. Okay, because this typically involves various field strengths, okay, Riemann tensor and so on. So what we need then is that del we need d mu epsilon x equal to 0. And not every epsilon x of course will satisfy this condition. Okay, the question is, are there any epsilon x which satisfies this? Those are the ones which will correspond to global supersymmetry. Since you have g mu equal eta mu nu, d mu is nothing but order derivative. Okay. So this is del mu of epsilon x equal to, which means basically the epsilon x is equal to constant. So that's parameterized by a 16 component constant Mahalanobis high scalar. So this we say, we describe by saying that the heterotic string theory or type 1 string theory in 10 dimensional flat space time has n equal to 1 global supersymmetry. Okay, n equal to 1 global supersymmetry corresponds to a supersymmetry with 16 components. Okay, 16 is the minimal you can have. Okay, because that's the form of representation of the Lorentz group. Okay, 16 is the minimal length representation that you can have, spinner representation. Okay, so this is said to have n equal to 1 global supersymmetry. Is this clear? And all the other fields, okay, I wrote down only for the gravity law. Okay, there is also a delay law, right? You can look at the transformation of the delay law. Okay. And what you will find is that the right hand side always involves derivatives of various fields and so on, which are all zero in this trivial background. Okay, so not only that the gravity of radiation vanishes for constant epsilon, but also the relative of radiation vanishes for constant epsilon. Is this clear? Okay, relative of radiation, also gauge of radiation, right? Because gauge fields also have the super partners. How do they transform? They transform by some gauge field strength acting on epsilon, multiplying epsilon. Okay, again, gauge field strengths are all zero in this background because you have set all other fields to zero. Okay. If you take heterodic string theory and put some constant gauge field strength, that will not preserve the superstring. Okay, because the delta of gauge will not vanish. So in the same spirit, type 2, you can ask, yes.
So the statement is heterodic or type 1 with
flat 10 dimensional space time.
But with all other fields to 0.
Yes.
That
flat 10 dimensional space time with all other fields set to 0, okay, will have n equal to 1 global super symmetry. Exactly. Okay. So in the same spirit, type 2 string theory, other 2A or 2B, in flat space time with all fields set to 0, okay, will have n equal to 2 global super symmetry because constant epsilon I. Okay, you can take epsilon 1 to be some arbitrary constant period, epsilon 2 to be 0, right? So that's one of the supersymmetric generators. Or you can take epsilon 1 to be 0 and epsilon 2 to be some constant period. Right? So it's parameterized by two independent 16 component spirits. So that corresponds to n equal to 2 global supersymmetry in type 2 string theory. Local supersymmetry is always n equal to 2. Okay? But global supersymmetry depends on the background. In this flat space-time background, it has n equal to 2 global supersymmetry.
Sir, I could not follow what all these other fields are in the background.
For the heterotic?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so we are specifying a specific configuration, right? We have said G mu equal to eta mu, no?
Yes.
All the gauge fields equal to 0, all the fermion fields equal to 0, the relator to be constant,
okay,
and so on, right? Or delayed to be 0, so I have said all other fields 0, so say phi equal to 0, but phi equal to constant will also do.
Okay. Yes, and sir, what does it mean by background here? You wrote the field
background, this is a specific configuration, field configuration.
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is what we will describe our vacuum configuration,
okay,
classical vacuum configuration. Yes. Then we will quantize the theory around this background. Okay. Normally, we will do automatic quantization. Right? Mm. You fix some background which solves classical equations of motion and then you study fluctuations around that. Right? So the background here is this background, right? And this background having global supersymmetry now means that the fluctuations that you have around this background, right, their effective theory will have this n equal to 2 supersymmetry, or n equal to 1 supersymmetry.
Is there any particular class of matrix backgrounds that help in having global supersymmetry?
Yes, so in 10 dimensions, if you want 10 non-compact dimensions, right, this is one. Right. The other class of background that is that preserves the same amount of supersymmetry, okay, is the ADS kind of background. Type 2B or ADS 5 times S5, for example, preserve exactly the same number of supersymmetries, 32. There are 32 global supersymmetries in that space time. Right. So you can classify what are the possible backgrounds with certain number of supersymmetries. If you want less number of supersymmetries, then there are more possibilities.
DS background, that also...
No, DS background breaks all supersymmetry. So that you can generally show that DS doesn't have any unbroken global supersymmetry. But typically for compactification, eventually of course you want to break all supersymmetries. Okay? Because our world doesn't have any supersymmetry. Nevertheless, for ease of analyzing the theory, it's useful to look for compactifications which are intermediate stage, preserve some global supersymmetry. Okay. And then try to find mechanism which will eventually break that global supersymmetry completely. Okay, it comes partly from phenomenological motivation because people have studied a lot of phenomenology with low energy supersymmetry. Right. So in those cases, the compactifications that we'll be looking for, right, will have supersymmetry unbroken at large high scale, okay, and then eventually at low scale you have to find some ways of breaking supersymmetry. Okay, and I will study these in some detail later. had any other questions? Another kind of background which we'll discuss in some detail, which preserves all the supersymmetries, is torus compactification. Right? You can simply take this 10 to 9 plus 1 dimensional space time, right? Keep the metric the same, and just periodically identify certain directions. Okay, so you are not changing the form of the background, that you are just having a periodic identification in some variable. And as long as epsilon is constant, right, it obviously satisfies those periodicity conditions. So those do not break any supersymmetry. So the number of global supersymmetry charges remains the same when you do this torus compactification. Yeah, but I'll be discussing that eventually. This is entirely equivalent, okay? Because y line is periodically identified with y line plus 2 pi, right? So the effective, the physical circumference of this compact circle, the periodicity, is r times 2 pi, okay? Because the metric is r dy. Okay, so this is exactly equivalent to keeping the metric to be eta mu hat and identifying y line. So we'll be using this convention. Now it's clear first of all that this background satisfies the equations of motion. Okay? Because after all, when you write down the action, okay, either of type 2b or heterotic or something, what form does the equation of motion take? Right? Einstein's equation is r mu nu minus half r g mu nu is equal to the energy momentum tensor, right, which is coming from the various other fields that you have in the problem. All those fields have been set to 0, right, so there is no energy momentum tensor. So Einstein's equation is just r mu nu minus half r g mu nu equal to 0, and r mu nu is obviously 0 because the metric is flat. Okay? R is just a constant. So it satisfies the equations of motion. It's also clear that this background preserves exactly the same number of supersymmetries as the original 10 dimensional space time. Right, because g mu nu is still eta mu nu, right? Or if not eta mu nu in that coordinate system, it's still a constant metric, or other background fields are still. So if you take heterotic string theory and do this compactification, you will still have 16 supersymmetries. If you take type 2 string theory and do this compactification, you will still have 32 supersymmetries. Now, what about the spectrum? What kind of low energy theory will this give? So, for that, we have to basically take the various 10 dimensional fields and do a Fourier expansion in this direction. So, this is standard Kaluza-Klein analysis, but let me just do it quickly anyway. So, example, suppose you have a massless scalar at n. So, it satisfies an equation of the form box phi equal to 0. Or let me write box hat phi equal to 0 because I am using this x mu hat for this full 10 dimensional index. But this is minus del 0 square plus rad square plus this time. Let me write the next one. Okay, so x stands for x naught to xi. Now, since yi is periodically identified, chi has to be periodic because period 2 pi. So you can expand chi in Fourier mode. Okay, y9 is periodic to period 2 pi, so this is the correct Fourier expansion. And when you substitute in this, we get the equation for chi n.
Which is minus L0 square plus that square plus minus
okay. So this basically means that N over R is like effective mass in 8 plus 1 dimension. Yeah, because this is exactly the equation that a Skinner field of mass n over r will satisfy. Okay, so chi n behaves like a field of mass n over r. Okay. And so if r is very small, typically you take r to be of the order of a string scale. Okay. But at least it has to be smaller than anything that we have observed today. Okay. That means that these non-zero n modes are irrelevant for today's experiment. Okay, so we can throw all the non-zero n modes. So only n equal to 0 modes are relevant, are massless. Okay. So what one does for finding the low energy theory, okay, is to basically keep only the n equal to 0 modes, which is equivalent to saying that we take chi to be independent of y9. Okay, to begin with, we had a field in 9 plus 1 dimension which depended on both the non-compact coordinates and the compact coordinates. Okay. But if you are interested only in studying the low energy physics, you can simply take the field to be independent of the compact coordinate and think of this as a 8 plus 1 dimensional field. Okay. So a scalar in 10 dimension will descend down to scalar in 9 dimension. So similarly, if you have a vector field, suppose you have a mu hat, a vector field. This again you can decompose. First, there is a mu, which you can write as sum over n, a mu n, to I n y 9, and a 9, which is sum over n, a 9 n, which is I n y 9. These are functions of x. Okay. And again, from each of these, you keep only the n equal to 0 part, because the others are mass, will become massive by the same analogy. Okay. So massless fields is in 8 plus 1 dimension are A9 and A. Okay. So this is a scalar and this is a vector. So you conclude that if we start with a gauge field in 9 plus 1 dimension, then after compactification on a circle, that describes a scalar and a gauge field in 8 plus 1 dimension. Similarly, if we start with metric, g mu nu, then you will first of all g mu hat nu hat. You will get a g mu nu, which is a metric, which is a rank 2 tensor. Then you will get g 9 mu, which is a vector. Okay, g mu 9 is the same as g 9 mu. And you will get g 9 9, which is a scalar. So a metric, will give after compactification a massless scalar, a massless vector, and the massless matrix, the gravitron. But of course, it has infinite number of heavy states which are thrown here. And again, if you want to have an ultraviolet finite theory, you have to put all those there, because it's only the full string theory, which includes all the excitations of the string as well as all the modes in the higher dimensions, that are necessary to get ultraviolet finite theory. Okay. It's just at a low energy. Okay, if you are studying the low energy physics, then you can ignore these things. So this also tells us how to write down an effective action in 8 plus 1 dimension. Okay, all you have to do is that you take the original action that we had, okay, and substitute in the original action these various fields, okay, with the understanding that none of these fields depend on y. Okay, and evaluate the action in this background. Okay. So the y integral basically becomes trivial, it gives factor of 2 pi, and then you are left with an effective action involving these fields. Is this clear? Now it turns out that this procedure is good for a quick counting. Okay, if you want to know, for example, what fields do you have after compactification, this is a very easy way to figure out. Okay, how many scalars you will have, how many vectors you will have, and so on. However, if we really want to derive the effective action, then this is not very useful. This is not very useful because the fields that we get this way do not necessarily have nice covariant transformations under the various symmetries that you have. Okay. For example, a general coordinate transformation in 9 plus 1 dimension will descend down to a gauge transformation and a general coordinate transformation in 8 plus 1 dimension. We would like to choose our fields in such a way that they transform nicely under these transformations. If we just do this naive identification of this sort, then it will turn out that in particular under the gauge transformation, this will not transform nicely. So next time we'll try to discuss how you define these low energy fields, the fields after compactification, okay, which have standard transformation laws under gauge transformation. Okay. And this is important because, I mean, just like we compared the effective actions to make a guess of what theory can be dual to what theory, we'll do the same thing after compactification. Okay. But to decide that this theory is the same as that theory, okay, we have to make an identification of what fields in this correspond to what fields in that. Okay. And in general, the fields here will be related to the fields there in a complicated way. Okay. One way to avoid it is to make sure from the beginning that the fields here and the fields there transform under the various symmetries in the same way. Okay. That already fixes possible relationship that they can have. Okay, so we'll learn next time how to do this, okay, how to define fields after compactification, okay, which have nice transformation laws under the various symmetries that we'll have in the theory after compactification.
So okay, this also holds for, say, 11 dimensions per gravity reduced to,
yes, exactly. So we'll apply the same formula.
All the tildes you get are basically because of.
Yeah, so we'll see that what happens, that when you take 11 dimensions of supergravity and reduce it, we'll have. It's basically exactly the same philosophy, okay? And again there, the way you have to define these fields is not exactly this, okay? There's nothing wrong in defining it this way. It's that these fields do not have the standard transformation laws, okay? So if you want to, I mean, compare, for example, 11 dimensions of supergravity on SRT with type 2A string theory, okay? To identify what fields in 11 dimension correspond to what fields in 10 dimension, okay, becomes hard unless you have some standard definition of the fields. And that's what we will try to find next time. Are there any questions? Yes.
So you see, EDS background preserves all supersymmetry.
Meaning that if you just, all is a very unclear statement because the epsilons are not the same, right? See, here the constant epsilons, in flat background, the constant epsilons preserve the symmetry, right? In ADS factors S5, it's not a constant epsilon which preserves the symmetry. Okay. There are epsilons which satisfy this d mu epsilon plus the dot 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 equal to 0. And the number of such epsilons is 32.
Yeah.
Right. So in that sense, the counting is the same, right? But to say that all the original supersymmetries are preserved by ADS is a little tricky statement.
So, I think from the actual string theory, string spectrum quantizing that in ADS background, one can also see that?
In principle, except that one
it is going to prove supersymmetry, global supersymmetry, that is only for supergravity in ADS background, or Sudan said it's for.
No, no, it's theory. Expected to be true for the whole string theory.
How does one guarantee that then?
The point is, people have formulated super string theory in ADS background, right? Not in a way where you can do systematic perturbation theory, but there are Green-Schwarz kind of formulation or the pure spinner kind of formulation that people have used to form write down a string theory in this background. There you can see that these supersymmetries are symmetry of theory, global symmetry, symmetries. Any other question? Continue.